In previous videos, we have discussed many aspects of the standard model. In this video, we will do something a bit different. While the standard model is a very good theory and it has passed rigorous testing, the theory doesn't tell us the full story. Thus, there are several limitations of the standard model and likewise a lot of things it doesn't take into account or explain. In this video, we will take a look at some of the biggest problems and gaping holes in the standard model, and we will discuss possible solutions that could take us to a theory beyond the current standard model. This is also the field I am personally working on, so it's an area of study which I have spent a lot of time on. Today's topic is therefore beyond the standard model. I would like to mention that this video is made in collaboration with Arvin Ash. If you would like an intuitive explanation to the equation behind the standard model, check out the link to his video in the description. There is a long list of small and minor issues with the standard model, but let us consider some of the primary issues. One of the most obvious problems is related to the absence of gravity. The standard model is a complete theory which includes the matter particles which make up the visible universe and the strong, weak and electromagnetic interactions. In school we however also learn about the fourth force called gravity, which is the one we have known for the longest time. The standard model however doesn't describe this force. The problem is very deeply rooted in the construction of the standard model. It has been proposed to just add a new spin 2 particle called the graviton, and this would take care of gravity. But this is not an obvious choice, it's just one idea from extrapolating on how we have described the world so far. Another solution is that gravity is a much deeper force which can only be described by some deeper theory. This seems to be necessary because the standard model is based on a static background. Thus, the way the standard model is defined is such that space-time is flat and cannot change while the standard model acts. This obviously makes the standard model incompatible with gravity, as it requires a dynamic and curved space-time to act. All of this boils down to the fact that the standard model is background-dependent. It depends on some fixed background of space-time. Therefore, we would need some deeper theory beyond the standard model to understand the link between gravity and the standard model. Another problem is that neutrino masses, according to the standard model, they should be massless. But we have performed many experiments and confirmed that this is not true. Neutrinos have a mass, but it is extremely small. One could just add mass terms to the standard model, but we still don't know the nature of the neutrinos and how to correctly describe them. We have also not determined if the masses come from the Higgs field, which is likely, but it's not clear. Neutrinos have this interesting property that when they propagate in space, they can change flavor, thus an electron neutrino can change into a tau neutrino, and this is all beyond the standard model, and only allowed if neutrinos' mass is non-zero. This is also called neutrino oscillation. About the masses, we actually don't know if the traditional mass hierarchy holds, thus we don't know if the third generation tau neutrino is heavier than the second generation muon neutrino. This hierarchy holds for all other particle types. Again, the issue is that neutrinos have a small mass and they are not easy to detect, thus it's hard to pinpoint their actual mass. Particle physicists are very happy about the standard model because it seems to describe the matter around us very well. Cosmologists, however, have a different opinion. According to the cosmological observations, the matter of the standard model only makes up around 5% of the energy of the universe. This means that there are a lot more stuff out there. Around 26% of the energy is some kind of a new matter. If you look at the standard model, this matter is not included. The standard model contains zero dark matter, but according to cosmology, there should be a lot more dark matter than matter of a standard model. This has led particle physicists to look for new dark matter particles in order to make a new standard model with dark matter included, such that it matches cosmology. This is not an easy task because, per definition, the matter is dark. The only known way it interacts with usual matter is via gravity. Gravity is, however, a weak interaction, and dark matter is just extremely slippery to work with. A lot of progress has been made, and a lot of experiments are going on, and hopefully the problem will be resolved within the coming decades. The rest of the energy of the universe is dark energy. This is even more mysterious than dark matter. The best attempts to explain this from the Standard Model led to a prediction that was 120 orders of magnitude different from the observed value. This is also known as the worst prediction in all of physics. Needless to say, dark energy appears to be way beyond the Standard Model. Another issue with the Standard Model is related to the matter-antimatter asymmetry. This is related to the fact that the universe is mostly made of matter. We once thought that there might be some places in the universe with antimatter planets or something like that, but that doesn't appear to be the case. But the question is, what happened to the antimatter? Why is it less preferred? Because generally matter and antimatter are equal. Thus, you would produce equal amounts of matter and antimatter. This is about symmetry, which we have discussed in the video about discrete symmetries. More precisely, it's about charge parity symmetry, and any theory that obeys this symmetry treats matter and antimatter equally. In the Standard Model, the strong and electromagnetic force obeys the symmetry, but the weak force does not. This means the Standard Model has a mechanism to produce a matter-antimatter asymmetry. But as it stands now, this mechanism is not strong enough to produce enough asymmetry. So again, we need to go beyond the Standard Model to get enough asymmetry to explain this difference between matter and antimatter. There are also several theoretical problems. One of these problems is called the strong CP problem. CP symmetry is the symmetry which has to do with the asymmetry between matter and antimatter. The problem is that theoretically nothing prohibits you from adding additional terms to the Lagrangian, where L is equal to nf g squared theta divided by 32 pi squared times f mu times f tilde mu nu plus psi bar, and in parentheses I d slash minus m times e to the power of minus I theta prime gamma 5 in the parentheses psi. The important part here is the angles theta and theta prime. If the parameters are zero, then everything is fine and everything works like in QCD. If they're not zero, they should lead to CP violation, thus the strong force would not obey CP symmetry, and the strong force would also lead to matter-antimatter asymmetry. The problem is that experiments strongly suggest that theta and theta prime are zero, or at least approximately zero. This leads to the question, why should these values be zero such that these values disappear? That is the CP problem. The Higgs sector is also a bit strange, especially with the current Higgs mechanism and Higgs sector. As it looks now, it is rather unnatural, and this is related to the hierarchy problem. If you compute the quantum corrections to the Higgs mass, then you get a huge number. This means that the bare Higgs mass must be finely tuned to match observations. There are also other questions, like why the 19 numerical parameters of the Standard Model are what they are. We would like some deeper theory to explain these numbers, or at least find some relation between them. This also leads us to some strange relations of the Standard Model. One interesting observation made in 1981 is that if you consider the masses of the charged leptons, you can construct a ratio where you have the mass of the electron plus the mass of the muon plus the mass of the tau particle. Then you divide by, in parentheses, the square root of the mass of the electron plus the square root of the mass of the muon plus the square root of the mass of the tau particle, and then you have all that squared, and this is roughly equal to 2/3. This ratio is within experimental error equal to 2/3, which might suggest that there are some hidden relations the Standard Model cannot explain. Likewise, the construction of the CKM mass mixing matrix is also rather peculiar. The Standard Model is by every means a good theory, but it is not the end. We should keep pushing to improve it and find some deeper theory that can explain more phenomena and hopefully explain the problems presented in this video. Some of you might have noticed that the new results from the muon G-2 experiment at Fermilab and the LHCb experiment have suggested that there are some cracks in the Standard Model, and thus this could hopefully help us guide us to a new theory that goes beyond the Standard Model. As always, I hope you learned something interesting. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. I hope you liked the video. If you did and would like to support the channel, check out the link in the description. Press the like button, subscribe and share it with your friends. Stay tuned for the next video.